good to see all these crazy teams out there. So many sports teams. Don't forget, New Testament, I think we covered this at Christmas time. You are allowed to have fun in church, okay? You are allowed to have fun in church. You're allowed to smile. You're allowed to laugh. You're allowed to say hi to people. It's great. It's so nice to hear laughter and smiles and be able to wear Buffalo Bills in church. Like, by faith. You guys think I'm crazy, and I am, but I am that person that I'm not letting go. So by faith. So it is Super Bowl Sunday, and I'm going to talk about the Bills for a minute, and I hope you will just bear with me, and then we'll just get it out of the system, and then we'll move on. But it is church Super Bowl Sunday day, and I gotta talk about it. So I am an avid Bills fan, okay? And I see all your jerseys, and they look very nice. I'm a sports fan in general, so I high five you there with your other teams. But I'm a Bills fan, unfortunately. I'm aware of that. So 3 years ago, the Bills got a new coach by the name of Sean McDermott. And when it was announced, it was right after they had this guy named Rex Ryan as their coach. And Rex Ryan was supposed to, like, change the Bills, you know? Like, this was going to turn us around. There's all this hype, and he's in for a year and out. And so they announced that this guy, Sean McDermott, is the new coach. And there's, like, a groan in you as a Bills fan because it's like, ah, here we go again. You know what I mean? Like, we got to start all over. Here we go again. Now, some of you are too young. Some of you are too old. It's either too young or too old. We forget how good the Bills used to be. Okay, so either you've never seen it in your life or you've just completely forgotten about it, such as myself. I'm too old to remember because there was a day, I call these the glory days, okay? The glory days where the Bills used to, like, score at will. I mean, they were fun to watch. Okay, like, it was great. I completely forgot about it until ESPN did this 30 for 30, and they did this segment on the Bills, and we're watching it, and I'm like, oh my gosh, like, I completely forgot. We used to score touchdowns. Like, this is amazing. And it used to be a lot of fun, and, like, Sundays weren't miserable because the Bills were winning, and it was amazing. Those are the glory days. It is true that actually leading up to the Super Bowl, the Bills were in 4 Super Bowls. No, I know, too soon. They did not win. But leading up to it, Rochester used to actually have 2 newspapers, the Democrat and Chronicle and the Times Union, okay? Now, like, you barely have a paper, but Times Union was like the afternoon paper. And leading up to the Super Bowl, they'd have this whole section on the Bills, and like a player, like a Bills picture was in the newspaper like every day. And I was that kid, New Testament. I cut it out, and I plastered my bedroom walls with Buffalo Bills pictures from the newspaper. So I was that kid, like 11, 12, 13 years old. That was me. So I also am that kid that cried after every Super Bowl. Skipped school, but that's all right. We're getting over it. So now we got this new coach 3 years ago, and he keeps saying this thing about cultivating a new culture and trusting the process. And it's like, cultivate a new culture and trust the process. Like, Buffalo, you've never had a process but losing for the past 20 years. Like, all we are mediocre at best. Anytime we had a little sliver of, like, winning or momentum was never sustained or built upon. We're, like, really just a system of failure, mediocrity, and embarrassment. I'm saying that as a Bills fan because I'm aware of our weaknesses here. And here comes this coach saying, building a new culture. And a Bills fan, your eyes are rolling like, whatever, you know? And yet here we are 3 years later, and I'm kind of trusting the process, New Testament. Like, I am all in with this process. Like, this coach of ours, of mine, happens to be a believer, praise the Lord. But his culture is simply this. He's building a team. And that sounds so silly because, of course, it's a team. It's the Buffalo Bills. That is a team. But he's building this team that's, like, unified and together, and building this team to be unified and together and have some hard work and discipline for this common goal of winning. And he also uses this word. My football coach uses this word I've never heard in football. He uses the word love. He's like building this culture of love, where they have love for each other on and off the field and for their families. And I'm trusting the process. And so he's building this new culture, and he had to make some tough decisions, and we've gotten rid of players that was like, oh, but I really like that player, but he kind of knows where he's going, and they've had to weed out some old habits and remove some old systems, but that's what culture is. Culture is a combination of what we create. That's what he's doing right now. He's creating something, what we create, and also what we allow. And so I understand that the Bills haven't arrived yet, but they're getting there. Case in point, very first game of the season, they play the Jets. We're down by like 16 points. Our quarterback had like 4 interceptions, and you're watching this game. Like Jimmy, when he doesn't even talk during a game, bad, okay? Like I'd rather have like angry Jimmy watching the football game, like what are they doing, versus like not talking at all. You know it's bad when he's not talking at all. Not talking at all. It was bad. And yet, we're down, and somehow Buffalo came back and won the game. And you're like, that's not normal. That is not normal. Then we're watching another game, and Buffalo had the lead. And then they lost the lead. And your head as a Bills fan says, same old Bills, same old Bills. Yet in the middle of that game that they lost the lead, at the very end, they marched down the field, and they scored, and they won the game. And I haven't seen that in forever. And I'm like, well, that's not normal. Then they play a game on Thanksgiving where everybody is watching. And it's a big game, which means Buffalo is not going to do well because everybody is watching. That's the Bills. And yet, they won the game with, like, dominant fashion. And it's like, well, that's not normal. Then they played a Sunday night game with the playoffs on the line. It is, like, in their hands. Like, they are in control of their destiny. And it was a tough game. And I was sick to my stomach with nerves watching this game. And the craziest thing happened, New Testament. Are you sitting? You are. The craziest thing happened. They won. And it's like, this is not normal. What is happening? Like, they're kind of turning around their culture. The same old Bills are not the same old Bills anymore. There's like a little bit of a more of an excitement to them now. Like things are changing. There's a little bit of a vibe going on. In fact, players say when you walk into the organization, walk into the stadium, walk into their practice facility, they can like feel the vibe. There's something to it. And that's culture. We're going to be talking about culture for a while here at New Testament. And culture is a vibe. It's this unwritten code that determines behavior. You can't see it, but it determines things and you can feel it. You know what I'm saying? You can feel it. Culture is the values, the principles, the beliefs, the underlying assumptions, the behaviors and attitudes that influence how life is lived by a shared group of people or how life is lived in a specific location. Culture is a combination of what we create, but also what we allow. And so maybe you found yourself saying this before in your home or somewhere, we just don't do that here. Have you ever been somewhere or said to yourself, we just don't do that here? That's culture. So back in the day when I grew up at Camp Shiloh, we love Camp Shiloh, buying soup after church goes to send our kids to Camp Shiloh in August. Back in the day, I myself might have, as a young, immature child, used to do some pranks at Camp Shiloh. And then, like, as we progressed at Camp Shiloh, we decided, like, no pranks. And so now leading the camp, like, you'll hear us say that. Like, if a kid tries to pull some pranks, it's like, well, we just don't do that here because that's our culture. Or you go to Camp Shiloh and kids just start worshiping like automatically from the get-go. There's no hesitation. Why? That's our culture. We worship. And so there's a culture to something. There's a vibe. There's a feel. There's this underlying thing. And so even with the Buffalo Bills, there's like just something happening. There's this new standard. There's this new expectation, this new vibe of love and respect for one another and hard work and this like changing the mentality where it's not the same old Bills anymore and changing the mentality that it's not just that we can win, but that we're going to win. So I am a woman of faith and vision. And so by faith, New Testament, their schedule next year kind of scares me. It's looking a little rough. It's tough. But by faith, Super Bowl 55, by faith, just might, by faith. I'm looking at all my Bills fans right now just to carry me. Might, by faith, have the Buffalo Bills. All right, I got out of my system. Where's Blaze? I have a couple Blaze kids. I have a question with the Super Bowl, and then we'll move on. So I had to make a diagram. Do you guys know what this says? There's an L, an I, and a V. Bam! Do they still teach Roman numerals these days, New Testament? Like, is this still a thing? Yeah. Yes and no. Yes and no. Okay, I guess it depends on the school you go to. All right, there you go, Blaze. Thanks for the help. Thanks for the help back there. All right. The other morning, it was actually Monday night. So it was Tuesday morning, Monday night. I woke up in the middle of the night and just felt the Lord like speaking to me. But it was in the middle of the night and I didn't write it down. And so I went back to bed. And when I woke up again, I woke up knowing that God had spoken to me and immediately thinking like I probably should have written that down. But thank the Lord, he brought it to my remembrance, and I wrote it down, New Testament, and this is what I sensed God speak to me. I sensed it for our church, and it was this. We're talking about culture for a while, but this is what God spoke. We are not pursuing new, and we're not pursuing change. We're pursuing God. We're pursuing God, who is the God who wants to do a new thing, and he's a God who created with change as part of the life cycle of life, the seasons, but we're not pursuing new or change. We're pursuing God. We're not pursuing miracles. We're pursuing God. We're pursuing God who works miracles, who conducts the impossible, who orchestrates the breakthrough. We're pursuing God. And if you know the mission here at New Testament, I bought a seatbelt last year because I like this clicking noise, okay? Like, I just like the clicking noise, so I play with it in my office sometimes. But our mission here at New Testament is connecting people. So this is like your visual for all the visuals. We connecting. There's a click right there. Connecting. Connecting people to God. How? By pursuing his presence, encountering his power, and seeing his promises fulfilled. We're connecting people to God by pursuing his presence, encountering his power, and seeing his promises fulfilled. Now, God's presence, there's his omnipresence where God is everywhere. God is everywhere. Emmanuel, God with us. So there's the omnipresence of God, but there's also his imminent presence. Okay, so God is everywhere, but yet he's imminent, he's close, he's near. The Bible says that he actually draws near to you. We always think of it, I have to do something to get closer to God. No, the Bible says that God draws near to you. It's his imminent, close presence. And so there's times that throughout your life, you're going to sense that he's going to even reveal himself at a specific time and a specific location, whether it's you individually, even to groups of people, in such a way that leads to a divine revelation, to a fresh revelation of who he is, of his grace, of his power, of his might, of his goodness, of his compassion. He reveals himself. So God is everywhere, but God is also here. He's all-knowing, and he's all-powerful, yet he's accessible, New Testament. He's accessible, and he draws near to his creation. He draws near to us. So I've said this often, and we want to kind of unpack this so we understand what we're talking about. I've said this often, this phrase, kingdom culture. We want a kingdom culture, the culture of heaven here on earth. We want heaven's culture shaping the value system by which we live. We want heaven's culture shaping the value system of the world in which we live in. We want heaven's culture shaping the value system of this church and how we live and how we move and how we act and how we speak. The culture of heaven is our vibe. The culture of heaven is our unwritten code that determines our behavior and our attitudes. It's kingdom culture. We're talking kingdom culture. And when we talk kingdom culture, this is what we need to realize. Bare bones right here, talking kingdom culture, realizing that everything in heaven is connected to the presence of God. Everything in heaven thrives around the presence of God. It thrives because of the presence of God. So a culture of heaven, a kingdom culture, is focused on the presence of God. There is nothing in heaven that exists apart from the presence of God. And so when we're talking a kingdom culture, we're talking the presence of God. And here at New Testament, we are pursuing the presence of God. We love everything about his presence. Psalm 73, this is my life verse. Whom have I in heaven but you? There is none upon earth I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God. But God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. I want Jesus and only Jesus. It's the presence of God. And so it's a value at our church. Embrace the pause. That's what we call it. Embrace the pause, where we establish rhythms in our life, where we even slow ourselves down, where we even set aside agendas to be with the Lord, to spend time with him, to be intentional about it, about being with Jesus. Because we understand this New Testament, the presence of God changes things. Okay? The presence of God changes you. Who God is at work in you, through you, and around you changes things. The presence of God changes things, changes mindsets, changes lives, changes economies, changes atmospheres, changes situations. The presence of God changes things. And so as we talk about pursuing his presence and being focused on his presence, we are not talking about worshiping 24/7, praying 24/7, reading your Bible 24/7. That's not what we're talking about. Being focused on the presence of God and pursuing his presence, what it means is that we are aware of his presence at work in our lives, period. Because he is at work in our lives 24/7, 7 days a week. Being aware of his presence at work in our lives. So there's some people who, when you eat, this is like the classic meal of meat, potatoes, and a vegetable, right? And so there's some that eat, and it's got to be like separated, like your food, like, cannot touch, you know what I'm saying? Like, holy cow. And then there's others that like got to mix it all together. A lot of times there's people like, nope, not a mixer, I'm a mixer. Okay, so like some of us live our lives with Jesus that way, like just like a compartmentalized life. I am a unique individual, and so I used to have 2 drawers of socks. And one drawer was my, like, athletic socks, you know. And then I had another drawer, what I called my, like, fancy socks, even though they're not fancy. They were, like, Irish socks or something, you know. But they were, like, higher and, you know, not my gym socks. And so, first of all, like, the two couldn't be together. Like, actually, to this day, I have my socks separated like that. They cannot be together. I got my athletic socks here and then my non-athletic socks here. But my dress socks were very much like I had white, like they were in the same drawer, but they were not just mixed together. That just drove me crazy. So I had the white socks and then the blue socks, or like just very compartmentalized because I'm OCD, and now I've tried to get better at mixing them. But a lot of us live our lives like this compartmentalized life, and yet God is involved, New Testament, in every area of our life. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is working in us. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you. And so the Holy Spirit is at work in you and through you and around you. And as we recognize his presence with us, as we recognize his presence at work in us, wherever we go and whatever we do, there's this realization that now everything I do is sacred and holy. There's a realization there. And as we continue to pursue that presence, there's even an awareness of the fact that we carry his presence, yes, but we don't carry his presence just for ourselves. We carry his presence for the sake of others. That's kingdom living right there. It's always about other people, a kingdom culture. We carry his presence for the sake of others. And so in the New Testament, 2 different times, Matthew chapter 6 and Luke chapter 11, Jesus was asked, teach us how to pray. Teach us how to pray. And so in Luke chapter 11, it says, so he said to them, when you pray, say, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. On earth as it is in heaven. Heaven on earth, a culture of heaven, a kingdom culture, the effect of heaven here on earth, meaning the presence of God and his values impacting this world. And how does that happen? It happens actually by you, New Testament, because it's his presence and his values impacting your life. Those values, that presence impacting your life, being seen on earth in your life, in your character. So when people see you, they see the Father. When people see you, they see his glory, his majesty, his beauty, his wonder, his compassion, his grace. When people see you, they see the Father and they glorify our Father who is in heaven. And so the reality of his kingdom, the reality of his culture, the reality of his world impacting your life, permeating your life, means that we become more like Jesus. It means we become more like Jesus. As we allow him to permeate and impact, we become more like Jesus, which then means that your life, this we lose, maybe we've never even had sight to see this, but so often we lose sight of this, that your life, because of this, your life enables others to encounter God for themselves. Your life positions others for their own relationship with God. Like that is powerful and huge. Your life, God uses your life so other people might know him. Your life sets others up for their own Holy Spirit encounter and transformation. We connect people to God by pursuing his presence. By pursuing his presence. And as his presence impacts and permeates every area, every aspect of our life, as it shapes our values, as it shapes our beliefs, our behaviors, our attitudes, we in turn shape the culture that we're a part of. We in turn shape the culture that you've been planted in, that you've been positioned in. We're called to shape culture, and there's no limit to that. We're told to limit your salt intake. We're told to limit our carbs. We're told not to eat too much sugar. We're told to watch our screen time and to keep that limited. You know, there's all these limits in life. Jesus never put a limit on the amount of influence heaven could have here on earth. There is no limit. There is no limit to the impact heaven can have here on earth, a kingdom culture. A kingdom culture. So in Genesis chapter 9, we're going to look this. I do a little habit of reading my Bible in a year, every year. And it usually starts me off in Genesis. So on January 9th, I only know that because this is Genesis 9. I was reading this and it just kind of just started speaking to me in terms of culture. So we're going to look at that for a few minutes. Genesis chapter 9. This is after the ark has landed. It says, "Now the sons of Noah who went out of the ark were Shem, Ham, and Japheth." And Ham, who names their kid Ham? I mean, there's some great names in the Bible. A friend was looking for Bible names, so I just started sending all these like crazy names. I don't know if I included Ham, but I double dog dare. Anyone out there? All right. Ham was the father of Canaan. These three were the sons of Noah, and from these the whole earth was populated. And Noah began to be a farmer, and he planted a vineyard. Then he drank of the wine and was drunk and became uncovered in his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brothers outside. But Shem and Japheth took a garment, laid it on both their shoulders, and went backward and covered the nakedness of their father. Their faces were turned away, and they did not see their father's nakedness. So Noah awoke from his wine and knew what his younger son had done to him. There's a lot in there. And this really isn't Noah's best moment. This isn't really like the highlight reel of his life, you know. Made a mistake, and there's this little section here. Now, is being a farmer wrong? Is planting a vineyard wrong? Is having a glass of wine wrong? Is having going to bed without your pajamas on wrong? Like, no, but he got drunk. The Bible says, be not drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. So we made a mistake in the sense of getting drunk, and that caused him to behave in this immodest, in this indecent, in this unbecoming manner. It's just not good. I mean, the guy is passed out drunk, naked, and exposed. Not really a good scene right there, okay? Not a good scene. And here comes his son Ham. Not a good name, but here he comes. And it says this, like twice they say, it doesn't say for his other kids, but for Ham, they say that he's the father of Canaan. Now the Canaanites became known as the most sexually perverted, morally depraved, bloodthirsty people group in ancient history. This is who Ham is the father of, okay? So not a great thing there either, but they mentioned it in the Bible twice. That's who he is the father of. Like modern day porn looks amateur compared to how these people were living, okay? So like, just morally defiled is who they were. And this is what it says about Ham when it comes to what happened with Noah making a mistake here. It says that Ham saw and he told. He saw something and then he told something to his brothers. So we all have been there before, not in Noah's boat, but we've all been there where it's like, well, you got something good to share. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I'm talking about? Like, you just get riled up. Like, I cannot wait to tell somebody. Like, guess what I heard? Guess what I saw? Guess what happened over there? Like, I can't wait to. You'll never guess. You'll never believe. And we just love those tasty trifles of, let me just tell you what I saw. See, Ham saw and he told. He's making a public ridicule. He's exposing his dad even more. He's shaming him. He's mocking him. Literally, he's delighting and gloating over this situation. You could even call it maybe being self-righteous where, wow, look at you, as I'm over here telling everybody else. He's delighting in this situation. And yet the very next verse says what his brothers did. But Shem and Japheth took a garment, laid it on both their shoulders, and went backward and covered the nakedness of their father. Their faces were turned away, and they did not see their father's nakedness. They in the midst of this not great situation, they showed some honor and respect, also a kingdom value. They showed honor and respect. They covered him. They covered his sin. They couldn't excuse what he had done. They couldn't excuse that, but they weren't about to magnify it and expose it even more. You know what I'm saying? They chose to cover, to turn away. See, we all know this because we've all experienced this. The world tears down. The world shames. The world condemns. The world, like, preys on your weakness and preys on your failure. The world highlights and gloats and all that. Not the church. Not the people of God. Not a kingdom culture. I mean, we walk around, not we, but people walk around, I call a relational crucifixion. I'm just waiting to nail you. I'm just waiting for you to mess up so I can nail you for it. People walk around with that attitude. Or in today's world, partly because of social media and whatnot, like you can give your opinion on everything. So I was at Leap and Laugh. You've ever been at Leap and Laugh? It's like right down the road. It's like this little bounce house place for kids. It's like $7 with Groupon, so it's great. You go get your kids just like all their energy out, and then they fall right asleep. It's great. So I'm there with the nephews. They're bouncing around. We take a little break, have a snack, and it's like, rate your experience. Like, just go on and rate your experience. We're always doing that, right? Like hospitals doing now. Rate your experience in the hospital. Like, we rate, and I have a good friend who every restaurant they go to, like, before they leave, they're on Yelp. They're giving their experience. But so often, we carry that critical and opinionated spirit with us wherever we go in our relationships with people. It's a Yelp spirit. We just are criticizing and opinionated wherever we go. Whatever we do, just laying it out there. But not the church. Not the people of God. Not a kingdom culture. Because the culture of heaven covers and builds up and brings healing and looks to help and restore. Doesn't mean, don't get me wrong, doesn't mean we excuse sin or turn a blind eye. Doesn't mean that. But we have the opportunity as the people of God to do for others what Shem and Japheth did for Noah. And so the Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 4, above all things, have fervent love for one another, for love will cover a multitude of sins. Meaning love, this is big for church world. Love chooses to forgive. And love chooses not to pick up an offense. Love chooses to forgive. Because a kingdom culture makes forgiveness the standard where we're committed to restoring, not abandoning, not punishing and condemning. The Bible, this is so powerful to walk in. The Bible says it's the goodness of the Lord that leads one to repentance. It's the goodness of the Lord, not me judging you and pointing the finger. That's not going to turn them to Jesus. Like, it's the goodness of the Lord that leads one to repentance, meaning grace, New Testament, is our default. Grace is our default. What if we spent less time managing sin and more time stewarding the presence of God? What if we spent more time stewarding the presence of God? Grace is our default. The prophet Zechariah had a vision. In Zechariah chapter 3, he has a vision of Joshua the high priest. And Joshua is standing there before the angel of the Lord, and right to the side of him is Satan. Okay, so he has this vision of this, and Joshua is filthy. He's filthy. In fact, some interpretations say he was like covered in like dog poop filthy. So have you ever like stepped in dog poop? My parents tried to spiritualize dog poop, and they called it manna growing up. And so we had to pick up the manna in the backyard. Yeah, yeah. And you wonder how we turned out. Dog poop is manna to the Crowleys. Did not eat it, but I have stepped in it before. And so you're like stepping it in your sneakers. Now it's like in the, you know how sneakers are, like in the crevices. So you're like trying to get it out. Now it's like smeared and all that. And then the smell, okay? Like the smell is the worst. Because even after you've cleaned it, like the smell just stays there. You know what I'm saying? Like, you can just still smell it even though it's gone. It's like, ah. That is Joshua right now. Just like, blah, it's just completely filthy. And there's Satan. Who is Satan? He's the accuser of the brethren. He comes to accuse and to condemn, but not the church, not the people of God, not a kingdom culture. And so Joshua is standing there completely unclean, and Satan actually has like a legit accusation. You are unclean. You are wearing filthy garments. Like, he's not having to like make something up here. But yet God speaks, and it says this in verse 4, then he answered and spoke to those who stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. Take away the filthy garments. Now, if they're being taken away, either they're being replaced or they're being taken away, and now I'm exposed even more. Now I'm embarrassed even more. Take away the filthy garments. And to him he said, see, I have removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you with rich robes. I have removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you with rich robes. We were watching a Netflix show the other day called Dead to Me. It's with Christina Applegate. And there's this scene where she, this would be crazy to do in real life. So she took a golf club, and there was this very fancy sports car that was irritating her. And she just like went up to that car and just took, she took the golf club and just started smashing it. I mean, she just like smashed the windows, just went to town on the car, and then drove away. And so in the scene that followed, the police came to her house. She's having like a party in the back or something. And they're like asking her, you know, it's like total TV world, so not real. But nonetheless, like they're like, did you do it? And she's like, no, I didn't do it. And her best friend is watching it. And the best friend goes, I did it. It was me. And she gets let off in handcuffs. Have you ever had someone take the fall for you? Like, have you ever with like siblings broken something, like you broke your mom's favorite mug and you know she's coming after you, and one of your siblings was like, I did it, mom, not them, I did it. Ever had that happen to you? Yeah, me neither. No, no, not once. Definitely don't have those siblings. Nope, haven't had them take the fall for me. Definitely not. But Jesus did. Took the fall for each and every one of us. Removing our sin, our shame, our guilt, our filth. And the Bible says that he clothes you. He clothes you with salvation. He clothes you with righteousness. He clothes you with the garment of praise. This is what Jesus done. He does. He clothes you. Salvation, righteousness, the garments of praise. Grace is our default, New Testament. Heaven is our culture, New Testament. Jesus is our theology. He's perfect theology. For the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten, full of grace and truth. The Son of God, Jesus, became the Son of Man, so that the sons of men, us, could become the sons and daughters of God. That's homework. I like to give homework. Write it down. Dwell on that for a little bit this week. Jesus, the Son of God, became the Son of Man, came to earth, so that we, the sons of men, could become sons and daughters of God. And so the Bible says to be imitators of God as dear children. And I think we'll talk about this in the weeks to come with the kingdom culture, because we're called to be Christ-like simply because we're made in his likeness and image. You are made in the likeness and image of God. And so when we act like Christ, you're actually acting like yourself, how you were made, because we were created to be on earth and to reflect who he is, heaven on earth. This is who he created us to be. When you're Christ-like, you're being who God created you to be. It's crazy. It's great. And yet sometimes we lose sight of Jesus in the midst of life. We lose sight of what he's done. We lose sight of his grace. We lose sight of his goodness. We lose sight of what's been extended to us. And as that happens, that's when we begin operating in the flesh. That's when we begin operating like with a Pharisee spirit, where we're looking to condemn, where we're looking to tear down instead of build up, where we're assuming the worst and looking for faults versus what grace does. And so we understand what Jesus has done for us, that he loves us and he's extended grace to us. And as we receive that, we then give that. And so receiving his grace and receiving what he's done for us enables us to love others with the same standard that he loves us, rather than the letter of the law. Grace is our default. Heaven is our culture. So the Bible says we live in the Spirit, but we also walk in the Spirit. So we choose daily to live in the fullness of his abundant grace. And that story with Noah and his sons in Genesis, to me, there's this measure of shame here. You know, like Noah did a bad thing, but here his son is shaming him. And what shame does, shame deals with identity, New Testament. Now the enemy looks to shame us. Shame deals with identity, meaning you're bad. Guilt is dealing with our action. I made a mistake, I made a bad choice. But there's a big difference between you made a mistake and you are a mistake. Big difference between those two. So the tactic of the enemy is shame. Shame takes confidence and turns it into confusion. Shame takes what we know is like final in my life, who I am, and tries to make it a question mark. That's what the enemy does. He'll try and take what is a guarantee, period, end of sentence in your life, what God has said, and turns it into a question. Are you righteous? Are you loved? Are you sure you're forgiven? Are you sure you're pure? Are you really holy? Are you set apart? Are you healed? He takes what God has already said and tries to make it into a question. Shame deals with identity, and shame causes us to hide. We see that with Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. They hid. They took on a new identity, hiding, losing sight of what God had said they were, who they were. You have to know. We have to know who we are. We have to know what God says. You have to know what God says. That's why we read the Bible. I have to know what God says, what he's done. He came to clothe you, New Testament, in robes of righteousness. We all have a spiritual need to be covered. And that's what Jesus did. He covered, but he took it away. Now he's replaced it with something else. He's covered us with those garments of salvation, righteousness, and praise. And so Satan wants to ridicule, expose, mock, shame, condemn. Jesus, he covers. His love covers. And as his love covers us, it frees us. Shame gone, burden lifted. It frees us. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set me free from the law of sin and death. It sets you free. Grace frees you, but it frees you, and now it frees you with others from a spirit of judgment and self-righteousness towards others. It frees us. It frees us. What if we spent less time managing sin and just stewarding the presence of God, connecting people by pursuing his presence? There's this article that we read a while ago, our elders, on millennials. And, you know, sometimes we bring up millennials and, you know, we'll roll our eyes or we got our opinions, right? But this article is talking about how millennials look at the church in general, right? The body of Christ. And the main synopsis is judgmental, negative, unopen, intolerant. Therefore, we don't want to go to church. And you're like, what? Not. Heaven's our culture. We're the people of God. And this is what the vibe is? Not the church. Not the kingdom of God. Psalm chapter 9 says this. We're almost over, I promise. Psalm chapter 9. I read this actually like right after that Genesis story because it was on the 9th. But it just so popped out to me after seeing what Noah's sons did. It says this in Psalm chapter 9. I will praise you, O Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all the marvelous things you have done. I will be filled with joy because of you. I will sing praises to your name, O Most High. I will tell, not slander. I will tell, not guilt, condemnation. I will tell of all the marvelous things you have done. Our mouths are for declaring the goodness and praises of Jesus. Our lives right here praising him are to be caught up with Jesus and what he's doing. I don't need to be worried about what you're doing. I'm stewarding the presence of God. That's going to affect you if you're near me, but I'm caught up with Jesus. I'm caught up with Jesus, connecting people to God by pursuing his presence. It brings you closer to Jesus. You can spend a lot of time on other things, but stewarding, I will praise you. I will tell of all your marvelous works. Amen. See, there's many diseases. There's a few diseases. I don't really know anything about health. Let's be honest. I'm not a nurse, but I read about it. All you nurses are going to correct me later on, so that's why I'm not going to go into detail. I just know that there are some diseases where the body turns against itself. Crohn's does that, where your colon basically eats itself up, right? How come that sometimes happens in the church? Where we do that towards people, men and women, whoever it might be, where we reject and turn on people. Because of that, there's a whole generation that doesn't want to be involved in church. Help us, Jesus. It says this, last scripture, Acts chapter 20. Heaven is our culture. It says this in Acts. So now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build up. Grace is a default. Grace builds up. Grace builds up. So there's a scripture that talks about apart from him, we can do nothing. We want to be connected to the presence of God. There's a movie back in 2008. Anybody ever watched The Curious Case of Benjamin Button? So with Brad Pitt, where he's born old and ages backwards and becomes young. That's kind of like the kingdom of God. It's very countercultural to how we think, because the Bible says that becoming more like Jesus is becoming childlike. Not childish, but childlike. And so often our thinking, our natural thinking is that, you know, we rely on ourselves for everything. We rely on ourselves. We don't have to depend on someone. But in the kingdom of God, apart from him, you can do nothing. So the kingdom of God says that we age backwards, and as we mature, I'm more aware of how much I need him. As you mature, I'm becoming more dependent on him. I'm more needy for Jesus. So a kingdom culture is dependent on the presence of God. We live in the fullness of his grace, and that makes grace our default, and we cover one another. That's our vibe, New Testament. That's our vibe. That's our culture. That's who we are. Kingdom, culture, heaven, here, on earth. Grace is our default. Would you stand with me? I want to make a couple confessions as we go. We're pursuing the presence of God. We're stewards of his presence. Heaven's culture is shaping our values. Heaven's culture is shaping how we live. And so grace is our default. Would you repeat after me? We are pursuing the presence of God. Awesome. We are stewards of his presence. Heaven's culture is shaping our values. Heaven's culture is shaping how we live. Grace is our default. Grace is my default. Jesus, I just thank you for each and every person here today. We're covered by the blood of the Lamb. We thank you, Jesus, for that. And we thank you, God, that you are calling us to love, restore, redeem, help, cover other people around us, God. We don't want to walk around how the world walks. We thank you for a culture of heaven that we can walk in. We thank you for that freedom that you've given us. We thank you, Jesus, that this week you are giving opportunities to each and every person here, divine appointments with others, where we can extend the love and goodness of Jesus to them, that they might glorify you, God. We thank you for that. I bless each and every person here today. Lord, you know the needs. You know what's going on. You are more than able to move every mountain that we need. So we thank you for that, God. You're moving mountains. You're working on our behalf. We love you, and we praise you, and we thank you for your covering over our lives. In your name we pray, amen. Amen. Have a great day, New Testament. Grab some soup. If you need prayer, you want someone to stand with you in prayer, we have a prayer room right off to the side here. Have a great day.